and I would have liked, I have instructions here that include just read this thing, or just look at the picture on my phone, which has things I wrote on the board in my office, so bear with me if I forget a step or two here or there. So let me state sort of our setting for today and the theorem that I hope to prove. So throughout today, I'll let X mu be a standard non-atomic probability space. If those words scare you, just think of the unit interval with Lebesgue measure that is actually perfectly general. There's no loss of generality thinking about that particular case. We're also going to philosophy of ergodic theory, I mean, it kind of got its start in physics, but the mantra that people wanted to show was that time average and space average are the same. So, I would say what I mean by time average, and then what I mean by space average. So, also, throughout this talk, let's fix an L1 function. Particular, we can take f to be Borel. Any L1 function is going to have a Borel representative. So let's define time average. So what you're going to do is, I'm a point in my standard Borel space. The transformation moves me over here, and I move over here, and I do that a few times, and I just record the average of the values of the function that I saw. So to be precise, I'm going to say, for a natural number n, the n average of f at point x is just going to be the average of the sum from k equals 0 to minus 1 of f of t k of x. So that's time average. Space average, let me just state the theorem first, then it might become clear what I mean by space average. So, this is the pointwise ergodic theorem, Zucker. I think it was proved in 1931. So, the limit as n goes to infinity of these averages at my favorite point, x, exists almost everywhere. So once we have this function that exists almost everywhere, it's a pointwise limit of a sequence, so it's going to be Borel also. We can think about what function this actually is. It's going to be equal to the space average, i.e. the expectation of f, let's say sigma twiddle. What is sigma twiddle? This is the sigma algebra of T invariant. But if you're not familiar with what expectation is, this part is kind of just a secondary observation. We're going to be most interested in this. Just here's a sequence of functions. Let's get pointwise limits. We'll show that these exist almost everywhere. more or less Birkhoff's original proof, maybe with a few modifications, but what you'll see in an analysis textbook is, so, proof outline. So you might do the following things. You might define f star of x to be the supremum of these averages, of the absolute value of the averages. You're going to prove what's called the maximal ergodic inequality. Inequality, which is the statement, what is that statement? It's the state measure of points whose f star is larger than alpha, is less than or equal to the one norm of f. Is just through some ad hoc method somehow prove the theorem, prove the Birkhoff theorem for a dense subset of L1. And so then once you have the Birkhoff theorem on a dense subset, you pair that along with a maximal type inequality, and then you get the whole thing. So for maximal inequality plus dense results is going to imply for you the whole result, or the whole theorem. So of these, one is just a definition. Three is not that hard. The dense subset of functions you write down are the invariant functions, or things that look like a difference like this. It's easy to show that for functions of this form, the Birkhoff theorem is true, and these are going to span a dense subset of L1. The tricky thing is this one. This is very non-trivial. So we're not going to do that work. What we're going to do is instead follow a very slick proof recently discovered by Anush Tserunyan. Let me write down the name quickly so that if you're interested at all in this proof or just basic background in descriptive set theory, she has loads of awesome notes on her website. So you should check it out. So, in particular, she wrote this, this is the entire thing, it's one page, a descriptive set theorist's proof. Three main ingredients. Two of which are kind of philosophical more than anything else, and one of which is actually a lemma that we'll need to do some work to prove. You can't get away with no work, you have to do something somewhere. So the first one is kind of philosophical. Uncountable standard Borel spaces are the same. And I guess this is underpinned by a theorem that you have to prove that given any two uncountable standard Borel spaces, there is actually a Borel isomorphism between their corresponding sigma algebras. But we're just gonna, that's not too difficult to prove, so I'm just going to take that for granted. particular, there is going to be a point in time where we're going to really want our space to look like cancer space, and that's going to be convenient. And so I'm just going to be free to do that because they're all the same. So this is, there's no measure floating around here. So this is just a statement about the Borel spaces.
Oh, just a small.
And so, yeah, and then a corresponding statement is true for, like, uncountable spaces with non-atomic probability measure. So the second one is another philosophical point, which is that descriptive set theorists often something that we do, so we have this transformation floating around on our probability space. Oftentimes, that transformation is like, it's too rigid to work with, so we kind of want to be a bit more flexible, and instead of just working with the transformation, we work with the induced equivalence relation. So, what is this equivalence relation? I look at two points. X is equivalent to Y if and only if they're in the same orbit. So there will be times when we kind of we deliberately mess with the transformation and tweak it a little bit. But in a way that still respects the equivalence relation, and that added flexibility, the ability to tweak the transformation that we're thinking about at any given time, can be useful. So those first two were more sort of just how should we think about this problem. The third one is actually a result. It's not a hard result. I hope to prove it if I have time. This is the Slaman-Steel part. Which I won't define just yet, but it's best to sort of be the technical tool that powers everything. Let me elaborate a little bit on I'll leave space under three. Let me elaborate a little bit on two, and then I'll return to Slaman-Steel. So we defined this orbit equivalence relation. Two points are equivalent if they're in the same orbit. So think of this, a useful visual to keep in mind is we have the standard Borel space, and this transformation kind of organizes the space into a whole bunch of Z lines, where I just have a point, and then T of X, and like T inverse of X, and then so it's going to give me a Z line. And so I'm breaking up the space into lots of Z lines. You might object, well, we might have like some like finite cycles, that's okay. Finite cycles for the purposes of I left out an assumption that this is an aperiodic invertible transformation. There are no finite cycles. Everything is a Z-line. if you want to deal with the cycles, they're really easy. You can just deal with them in a finite amount of time.
Seems like we're treating the circle by irrational.
Yes, that is a good, so think of that as breaking the circle apart into these Z-lines.
Yeah.
Alright, so the philosophy, and two, we need some terminology to back up this philosophy that dealing with the equivalence relation is better. So let f be a subset of x squared, be an equivalence relation. I call f is a subequivalence. Of et. kind of annoying definition, which no one really likes, but it's just standard and now we're stuck with it, is this abuse of the word finite. So we say that f is finite if all f classes are finite. So it is not set theoretically finite, it's just we're breaking up the space into a bunch of finite chunks. And we're going to often be interested, we're often going to want to modify, we're not just going to deal with any old equivalence relation. I might use the word Borel equivalence relation. That's going to be Borel as a subset of this product.
You mean F classes mean by like sub equivalence classes?
I mean, this definition doesn't depend on being a sub equivalence of ET. But I mean, everything I'm looking at is going to be a sub equivalence of ET. And we're going to be breaking these Z lines up into like finite chunks. Did that answer your question?
I don't get it. What is F classes?
Oh, so an F class is just a class of things that are F related. So here's, say that I have like an ET class. ET classes look like these Z lines. And I might arbitrarily break this apart into smaller chunks. So here's a smaller chunk, and here's a smaller chunk. And so I'm going to, so here's like x and y, and so I might say here that x is f related to y because they're in the same chunk. F being finite just means that all of these chunks are finite. So, the next one other definition that's a little bit weird, but really sort of underpins this philosophy that the equivalence relation is sometimes better to work with than the transformation itself, is this following definition. So we had a measure preserving transformation, and that just means that transformation moves the Borel set, and the measure of the Borel set appears the same as it was over here. Let's talk about the notion of a measure-preserving equivalence relation. It's a little bit weird, because what does that mean? I'll just restrict to the, actually I don't even need to restrict to the finite case. So a Borel equivalence relation is called, so let's say I have a the measure mu on my space x is called, so let's say it's mu preserving. If for any Borel B subset of x and any Borel injection. Relation? Oh, let me give this a name. This equivalence relation is named E. Then the measure of B is the same as the measure of phi of B. So what's the philosophy here? What should we keep in mind? So a transformation gives rise to an equivalence relation. And an equivalence relation could in turn give rise to loads of different partial transformations, i.e. those partial transformations where a point has to be e-related to its image. But aside from that, I allow a lot of flexibility. So this just says whenever I have a partial Borel function, or partial Borel injection, from some subset of x into itself, so that every point is e-related to its image, I demand that the measure stay the same. So one way of producing a measure-preserving maps that we're going to do is we're going to have, we had our measure-preserving T from before, and we're going to do something like break up the space into chunks like this, and then we're going to do something where like we follow T until we're about to leave a chunk and then go back. And then we're going to follow T until we hit, we're about to leave a chunk and then we go back. So we're going to mess with T a little bit. We're going to, it's going to look like T on a lot of the space, but we're going to have the flexibility to perturb T a little bit on a set of small measure.
Okay.
Oh, yes?
Maybe rotational confusion. I just see my measure bar, right? Always in some space.
X is the standard Borel space. I'm suppressing the notation for, think of it as the unit interval, and it just comes with its signature of Borel sets.
Right, so I don't understand why you say, so each X relate, F relate to Y, and you say that X and Y are finite. What does that mean?
X and Y are
finite.
So F is going to, F just breaks the space X, so right. forget about the sigma algebra for a second. So X is just a set. F is going to be some equivalence relation. I'm going to demand that all the chunks are finite, all the equivalence classes are finite.
Oh, I see.
So then in addition to finite, we can also demand that the equivalence relation be Borel as a subset of the product sigma algebra. But we can sort of, those are independent constraints.
So F is a collection of those chunks.
Yeah, so F is going to be the set of pairs in the same chunk. Some notation, and then I'm going to prove a quick lemma. Say that F is a finite Borel equivalence relation, and earlier I defined these time averages of this function F that we're talking about. So now I'm going to define equivalence relation averages of the function. So M sub F of F at point X is going to be 1 over the cardinality of bracket X F, the sum over every Y in X's equivalence class of F of Y. So this operation just takes a point, looks at every other point in its finite equivalence class, and just takes the average. So the finiteness is key to that definition. It wouldn't make sense if the class was not finite. So then here's the lemma, which is going to be kind of another technical tool, which is going to be sort of the idea that if I'm going to cook up wacky transformations that look like this, but it'll still be fine. It's still going to preserve the measure. So if I start with a finite measure-preserving equivalence relation and create a transformation out of that, I don't change the measure. So the lemma is that the integral of f(d) mu is equal to the integral of mfd mu. So, proof. First thing I'm going to do is the equivalence classes are all finite, so let's partition the space into countably many pieces based on the size of these equivalence classes. So this will be a disjoint union of x sub n, where x sub n is going to be the union of all those classes with exactly n elements. So this will be the classes with exactly n elements. time spaces are more or less the same. So this is xn, it kind of looks like the real line now. And say that I have one of these classes of size n. So here n is 4, there are 4 elements in this class. I'm going to distinguish the least element, and I'm going to let b be those set, the set of points in xn, so that x is least in bracket xn. And this is Borel just because this is a Borel linear ordering of xn. Now we just need to... So notice that this B is what is called a... This is a Borel transversal of F. B meets every equivalence class exactly once. So now I can write Fg mu. I'm going to use here the fact that we have a mu preserving equivalence relation. So it's going to be the integral over B of the sum pi less than n f t by x. So what's really going on here? This is saying that this is using that the measure of Ti inverse of B is the same as the measure of... Oh, I haven't told you what T is. This is not the same... Let me use a different letter, because it's not the same T as before. T is going to be the following... Or, I don't want to use T. What's a good letter? Sigma. Sigma is going to equal map above. I'm just going to draw what sigma is. Sigma is going to do this. Sigma. So this is a Borel transformation. Sigma.
This is just the example right now. Because
this is
something
that's possible. Well, this isn't. This is not quite T. This linear ordering on xn has nothing to do with T. No, not right now.
Okay.
Right now it's just a... Oh, I'm sorry, I didn't tell you what assumptions I'm using. So f needs to be a finite mu preserving. So all you need are these assumptions, and then this lemma goes through. And so I'm just going to cook up this linear ordering in the sigma. Since sigma, the graph of sigma is contained in F, because I just mapped points to equivalent points, this equality holds, and then if we read what that means, this is going to be the same thing as, I'm just adding up the points, the points in an F class, I could also add up their averages, that's the same thing. F of sigma I x, and then I go back once again using the fact that f is mu preserving. Oh, these are all d mu x, and this is going to be an integral. And so then, yeah, we do this for every xn, and then that's the whole result. Alright, so that was sort of the background needed for this equivalence relation philosophy. So now let me talk a bit about Slaman-Steel. And what I think I'm going to do is I'm going to state Slaman-Steel, and then use it to prove the theorem. And then, given time, I'll try to prove Slaman-Steel. I might not have time to prove Slaman-Steel. So, let's get some definitions down. So, the Slaman-Steel marker lemma was proven by Slaman-Steel in the early 90s, in the late 80s. Do you remember when that was proven?
1970.
Okay, 19-something. It concerns the existence of things called marker sets, so I should tell you what the marker set is. So yeah, now, for this definition, we're going back to our setup of x mu, t is the same transformation as before. A marker set is a Borel, a subset of x, which meets every t orbit. Equivalently, it meets every ET class, because we think about equivalence relations sometimes. A marker set A is by infinite instead of writing down an annoying to write down a definition, I'm just going to draw an easy to draw picture. It's the same thing. So a marker set has to meet, so here's an equivalence class, it's just a z line with respect to the transformation t. Remember, every equivalence class, every t equivalence class looks like a z line because we're dealing with an aperiodic transformation. This goes on forever, this goes on forever. The marker set A has to meet a point somewhere in this line. By infinite just means I have to meet arbitrarily many points in this direction, and arbitrarily many points in this direction. So no class has a leftmost member of A, or a rightmost member of A. A meets every class infinitely often to the left and to the right. And then here is the statement of the marker lemma. So let's think for a bit about what is and is not permissible as a Borel marker set. So Clive mentioned the example earlier of irrational rotation. And one of the easiest ways to cook up a non-measurable set is to try to cook up a marker set that meets each equivalence class exactly once. If you attempt to do that, you're going to cook up a non-Borel set. So oftentimes, you're not going to be able to get a Borel selector. So necessarily, our markers are going to have to be kind of indistinct. They meet the class, but not just once, like kind of lots of places in some way. But we can try to get those meetings to be more and more sparse. And that's the content of the Slaman-Steel marker lemma. So Slaman-Steel marker lemma. So there exist marker sets. A0, subset of A1, subset whose intersection is empty. So sometimes this whole system is called vanishing marker sets. So Slaman-Steel proved the existence of vanishing marker sets. And so this is good. This kind of means that we can get arbitrarily sparse. And that's technically useful for lots of things, including the proof of this theorem. So let me actually prove the theorem using the marker lemma as a black box. And in time permitting, I will prove the marker lemma. Alright, so we're going to prove proof of Birkhoff. We want, I'm going to write F bar to be the Ling soup, and F under bar to be the Ling inf. Well, let me add, I should just write down what I mean. So the Ling soup over N of these time averages, which is defined to be F over bar, should be less than or equal to F under bar, which is defined to be equal to the Ling inf F almost everywhere. This is what we are trying to show. This would prove pointwise. So towards a contradiction, say that the set X prime, oh, and let's say, yeah, so there are some A less than B, so that the following set would write down those points. F under bar of x less than or equal to a, strictly less than b, less than or equal to f over bar of x, is positive measure. So, without loss, so notice this x prime is going to be invariant, because the averages are going to see like more and more of the points neighborhood in its orbit, so X prime is going to be a T invariant set. So I'm just going to say that X prime is equal to X. If not, just like throw out the rest and then blow up the measure to get back to a probability space, and that's your new X. So we're going to say that we have this bad behavior. Okay, so let's fix epsilon greater than zero small. This small is going to depend on like b minus a. We'll decide what it is later. Find L a natural number large enough. The following set, Z, is this is those points, so that for 1 less than or equal to n less than or equal to l, I have m, n, f of x less than b, has very small measures smaller than epsilon. Oh, even worse, I want the integral over z of 1 plus f t mu. 1 plus absolute value of f t mu plus an epsilon. I can certainly do that. Why? Because I'm assuming that the Ling soup, Ling everyone's soup is above me. So I can't always have I can't always be in this situation for any X. Almost everywhere there's going to be a point where MNF of X is greater than or equal to B. So the idea is that most of the time, as we start looking at more and more averages, we know that the lim soup is above B, or at least as big as B. So we're going to see n's where this is at least as big as B. So I can't.
That's a greater equal to.
No, it's a less than. It's less than, but then as L gets larger, fewer and fewer points are going to satisfy this, and it has to vanish eventually. So we're going to banner that has a very small measure. We're going to map L from omega by L of X equals largest n less than or equal to L m n f of x is greater than or equal to b. This is if x is in z, or otherwise we're just going to set it to 1. And a useful notation will be the set on the interval related to x, it's going to be x, t of x, all the way up to t, l of x, minus 1 of x. So in particular, if I'm not in this second case, and I look at the averages here, I know that the largest one. Huh. Alright, ignore my comment. We'll see what happens. I might want that to be the smallest one, but in either case, unless if we're going to be counting from the left or something, we'll see what happens. Alright, so let's use the marker lemma. We've not used the marker lemma. So the marker lemma is going to, I left out an important extra bonus in the conclusion of the marker lemma. These are going to be bi-infinite. So let's grab, use marker lemma. I defined marker set and then I defined by infinite.
Oh, okay.
So I want by infinite marker sets. Yeah. So use the marker lemma. Let's find by infinite. S subset of X. So that I want to have a really small measure. But actually, not just S, but I actually am going to fatten S up a little bit using T. So this is the union I less than L, T minus I of S, has the integral over S prime, 1 plus absolute of F, D mu less than delta. I don't know what delta is, it's going to be really small. So now, what marker sets, this is an illustration of what marker sets are useful for. So let's think about our bi-infinite, our line. And then we have these markers. So gaps appear by infinitely often in every Z line. These are the members of S. So here's a member of S. Here's a member of S. Here, say that L is like 3 or something, so here is like S twiddle. There's going to be a region behind each block that looks like S twiddle. But S twiddle isn't too big. The S twiddle blocks are like pretty far spaced. But they have to be small enough bins and they're really small. And now we're going to take the Z line and split it up into a finite Borel subequivalence relation. And once again, let me write down the definition, but I'm going to draw a picture that's better. So, XFY, if and only if there is a Z not in S twiddle, so that S of X, oh, I've not told you what S of X is. Here's an X. Here's S of X. I'm going to start looking left until I hit a point of S, and that's S of X. So there's a Z, so that S of X equals S of Y equals S of Z. So here is a point in S, and we're going to start marching forward with our transformation. So remember, every point had this L of X, which is just some number that we assigned to every point, and we had this interval corresponding to that number in that point. So here's the first point not in S. I'm going to draw a little interval. So here, this first point would be, if this was a point y, this would be t sub l of y. And then this point is going to have its own notion of interval, etc. So a bunch of intervals are popping up. Oh wait, here's the next point of S. That's kind of bad, we don't want to approach it. And worse yet, S twiddle kind of reaches out further left of S. So here's the next point of S, here's S twiddle kind of reaching out, that's bad. So maybe here's a point, and it's not in, but then the end point of its interval, it starts meeting S. So that's the last one we're going to consider. And now what's the equivalence relation? The equivalence relation is just going to be as follows. Here's a class, but then everything after this is a singleton. These are just singleton classes, including the points of S. So this is the picture, and the one thing I want the picture to make clear is that any non-trivial class, so the classes are either just going to be points, or they're going to look like some one of these intervals. Alright, and this is where my notes tell me to just follow the paper, so we're going to see what happens. this is I didn't write it down formally, but it's the element of S next to the left.
So you transform it X.
Yeah, so here's X. I march left, I march left, I march left. Wait, I get an element of S. That's about it. So we're definitely using the bi-infinite assumption is creeping in. So the domain of S, the non-trivial classes, do not hit squiddle. Wait, I want them to not hit S. Z not an S. S Z to Z is tile. So I now Z. So that's a little bit unclear. But what we want to claim is that the set the points supporting non-trivial F classes, domain of F minus that the integral of x plus y t mu, its measure, plus, let me just write it like this way, 1 plus f t mu is less than something like 2 epsilon. So the one thing that's worrying me is this claim that the domain of F is going to be supported outside of S twiddle. It kind of looks like we might hit S twiddle just a little bit. I think domain here is being used the union of the non-singleton equivalence classes.
Okay.
So let's call that the domain. I'm silly. The domain contains. Okay, I'm silly. I can't read set conclusion. The domain of F contains X less S twiddle. It may also contain parts of S twiddle. That's fine. That's how subsets work. Okay. Each F equivalence class is of the form IZ. Okay, I just can't read. So this is going to be small. I guess this is where I had to tell you what epsilon was. So what was epsilon? So the way she does it, she says epsilon at the beginning and sets it so that B minus A, so this was this on the start of our contradiction, we had the lim sup above B, the lim inf below A, so B minus A, the measure of X, oh, but I'm just going to say that X is probability, should be greater than 2 epsilon absolute A plus absolute B plus 2. Okay, that seems reasonable. So 2 epsilon is less than 2 epsilon is less than, how do you get greater than 2 epsilon? Oh no, less than 2 epsilon. going to be greater than or equal to b, because y was defined as the domain of f less z. So it's all those points not in. This is going to kind of convolute. You need to remember what z was. So remember that z was the set of things of x and x, so that for every n, l, the average less than b. So points not in z, so if x is in the domain of f less z, in particular, that means that the f average, you're just a singleton, because we set that little l of f equal to 1. So in particular, f of x has to be greater than or equal to b for those points. So here on the complement, so that's this observation for y in y, and f of y just equals f of y, and it has to be greater than b. So outside, we want to claim that we're less than 2 epsilon. Because otherwise, so the domain of f less, so what's x less y? X less y is either things in z or things in, what am I trying to say? Things in z or things in s twiddle. So the things in s twiddle are going to be small. S twiddle is really, really small. Okay. And I apologize for not explaining this terribly well, but it is cooked up to work. So what is the takeaway? The takeaway is we have this. So the takeaway is that the integral of f t mu is greater than the integral of f t mu minus 2 epsilon which is greater than or equal to b minus 2 epsilon absolute b plus 1. And then we have to mimic the argument for lambda infinite a, and then we're going to get a contradiction. We're going to get 50 minus a less than or equal to 2 epsilon a plus b plus. So let's see if I can salvage something here. So yeah, we wanted epsilon to be kind of small, and then here we're constraining epsilon to be kind of big. The way that we're doing that is we're breaking up our space. Over here, we have a lot of control over how our function looks. Over on x less y, in these equivalence classes, x less y plus z. Oh, because the domain of f is huge. The domain of f is going to contain x less s. And this is s twiddle I think this was just meant to be, we set S twiddle to have really small measure. S twiddle had really small measure, I think I call it delta, but it really just needs to be epsilon. So this is size, not just measure epsilon, but like 1 plus F is measure epsilon. Oh, you have a question? Okay, so on S twiddle, on X plus S twiddle, we see most of the function. Z sees very little of the function. So this is actually really easy. I'm sorry, this was not hard at all. This is literally just the assumptions that we cooked into these sets. How we solve this takeaway? This takeaway, we use the fact that F is... Yeah, let me explain this last step a little bit. This last step, we're going to use... So we have this minus 2 epsilon fudge factor. We know that capital F is measure preserving. And we have a lot more control over this average, because it's going to look like it's at least B measure of Y minus 2 epsilon. And the measure of Y is not bigger than 1. And so that's where we get B measure of Y, or B... Yeah, so then this is greater than or equal to B... minus 2 epsilon times absolute B plus 1. So this is all just fudge factor. The key thing here, this is the key step, the measure preserving step. Okay. So apologies for bungling that a little bit. Let me try to, I'm not going to have time to prove the marker lemma. Let me explain some of the ideas going on. Because that's also cool descriptive set theory. Let's erase this.
Yes? How big is one?
Smaller than one.
Yeah, but like, I don't know.
Are you trying to justify the box?
Yeah.
Oh, so we cooked in a lot of assumptions. So what we cooked in, this set Z was super small. So what is x less y? X less y is contained in z union s twiddle. So we're assuming that z is super small. We're also assuming that s twiddle is super small. Yeah, so that's the relevance. So
that's
sort of a subset of z union s twiddle. And we actually cooked these up to control the integrals of 1 plus absolute. We just code that directly.
And also mass of F is in S triangle and also small, so
So this is just the first one.
Where did you use the box that we called in the last
one? Right. The integral of F. Oh, I think it's this very last. Controlling the integral off of... Oh, it's this step, right? Oh, I forgot an important subscript. Here's the integral over x, here's the integral over y.
Okay, yeah.
So I'm integrating over and then just forgetting the rest and calling it a fudge factor. And then this is over y. This is where the measure of y pops up, and then the measure of y is this one. Again, some fudge factor. Alright, five minute rapid fire proof of the marker lemma. No call today. So remember I remarked earlier that we want our standard Borel spaces to be uncountable standard Borel spaces is gonna be anything we want. So I'm gonna take it to be Cantor space. Let x equal 2 omega. have this, so let's, this is totally in the Borel context, there's no measure. So T is just an aperiodic Borel automorphism. So I have these Z lines, and I'm thinking of them as equivalence classes. Here's Cantor space. Topology that's kind of nice. So I'm going to think about, so given a point in space, I'm going to let x sub y, or I don't like that notation actually, how about phi of y equal the lex least element of class of Y's closure. So you might be a little bit skeptical, like why on earth is this Borel? It's because we are closure plays nice. So you can reason about this entirely in terms of like the finite strings that define the neighborhoods. So I say this neighborhood contains an element of bracket Y. Any lexicographically preceding neighborhood does not contain a member of bracket Y. And since there are only countably many finite binary strings, that's definitely Borel. And now, a rough idea. A first approximation to these ANs is that AN is going to be close to those x, or those y's, so that y restricted to n equals 5 of y restricted to n. This is super close to working, but there's a problem, which is that the intersection over all the ans, it might not be empty, it might contain it could contain, if this lex least member of the closure is actually in the class itself, it might contain it. That's bad. And there's no guarantee that these ans are by infinite. So now we have to tweak it to get by infinite. And to get the, and once you have by infinite, it's really easy to tweak it a little bit further to get this property, the vanishing property. And I don't want to keep you any longer, so I think I'll stop there. And so I'm demanding that I have more and more agreeance with the leftmost branch. August?
So, is this, like, a lot easier than proving the maximal inequality, or...?
I think this depends on the philosophy. So, the maximal inequality is not easy. I think why I favor this argument is it's very natural. These are very natural things to do if you're comfortable with some ideas from descriptive set theory. In particular, this idea of carving out finite sub-equivalence relations and reasoning about those. shows up all the time in descriptive set theory. So the idea that those styles of argument can prove something like this is kind of cool. And that being said, it is obviously easier if you are a priori more comfortable with these things. Also, it might look less scary if I presented it in a clearer fashion, but that's subjective, so.
Has this been applied to prove some of the Ergodic theorems?
That is an excellent question. The issue, yeah, because it's kind of an open question. What groups have pointwise Ergodic theorems?
Mm-hmm.
And so marker lemmas are totally general. And generalize marker lemmas in all sorts of direction. The bit that gets a little bit harder is the geometry. We really use this C-line geometry to carve out these finite set equivalences. It's similar. We're really toying around this idea that equivalence relations created by Z actions are hyperfinite, and that's a big open question. Like, do all amenable groups generate hyperfinite equivalence relations? So
at least this works for a whole lot of hyperfinite.
I believe so. I don't want to say too much. But yeah, it seems like if you can get a reasonable finite sub equivalence that does the things that you want, that's what's driving this proof.
And a correction, Slaman-Steel was proved in 88.
88, okay.
Just I see random walk.